Welcome back to the Middle Tech Podcast. You've got Logan Jones here recording out of the Awesome Inc. studio in downtown Lexington, Kentucky. And on this week's episode, Evan and I got to sit down and interview Bradley Davis, who is the founder and CEO of Podchaser. So we got to talk to Bradley about his background, how he actually started this company by posting in a Reddit thread, and also where he sees the podcast industry in general going into the future. So if you listen to this podcast, I'd be willing to bet that you pay a decent amount of attention to what's been going on in the space recently. So we've seen a ton of growth and momentum as companies like Spotify continue to invest and make acquisitions within this space. So to name a few of the big moves that Spotify's been making recently, they've now acquired the platform Anchor, which allows podcasters to publish on all of the different platforms. They've acquired Megaphone, which is going to allow for dynamic ad placement within podcasts. They've bought exclusive rights to the Joe Rogan podcast and the Michelle Obama podcast. And they've also gone out and purchased companies like Gimlet Creative, which are full-on production companies that produce a whole variety of different types of podcasts. So a ton of money going into the space right now because of those investments that Spotify is making. So we got to kind of nerd out with Bradley and talk about all that's been going on, as well as the company that he's building within this space right now. So we really enjoyed this conversation. We hope you guys enjoy it as well. We're going to go ahead and dive into it. All right, guys, we're sitting here live in the Awesome Inc. podcast studio. We got Logan Jones and Evan Knowles here. We're sitting down with Bradley Davis of Podchaser. He is someone that just recently relocated to Oklahoma City, but company was started in Louisville, Kentucky, so we're looking forward to sitting down with him. Where's most of your team nowadays?
Our team is in Oklahoma, Texas, Hawaii, New Zealand, the UK, and Australia, and North Carolina.
It's been that way since day one, too. It's been a fully distributed team since you guys started, right?
Yep.
Awesome. You guys were ahead of the game. Now everybody's
now it's in fashion. Yeah.
Very cool. Well, appreciate you for joining us, man. We're looking forward to this. Your company is playing in the space that we are obviously playing in, and you guys are playing in a really big way. We're looking forward to diving into what you guys have created. Because it's really exciting. What you just showed us prior to recording was some exciting stuff. So we're looking forward to diving into some of your new products. But before we get into Podchaser or any of those products, let's dive into you. So tell us about your background, where you're from, your education, and then briefly talk about your professional background up until Podchaser.
Sure. So I was born in Florida, in Jacksonville. I lived there till I was 10, and then I moved to Evansville, Indiana, and I identify as a Hoosier, as my birthplace. I lived there through high school and college, and I majored in psychology, very, very useful degree, and my career path was to be a psychotherapist. So,
what is a psychotherapist? Talk about, I don't know what that is.
A psychologist, so like it would be like a PhD or PsyD and do talk therapy.
Got it, okay.
Which is actually what we're going to do today. So I hope you're excited to dive in.
Totally change the course, guys.
Yeah. So I went to school for psychology. I got a job as a counselor. It was terrible. And then I moved to Louisville, Kentucky, and I got my MBA from Ball State out of Indiana. And I professionally got into sales. So basically, after my short stint as a mental health professional, I wanted out. And I was like, shoot, what am I going to do with a psychology degree? So you can get a sales job just by having a heartbeat. So I went out to apply for sales jobs. I had worked at Best Buy selling TVs. I was very good. I sold $1 million worth of TVs in my first year, which you do not make commission on, by the way. So making $9 an hour. And I thought, like, okay, well, what can I do? What can I sell in the Midwest? And quickly, accidentally settled on industrial sales. So for those listeners who have no clue what that is, selling supplies and goods to manufacturers. So I would be driving around selling. I sold packaging. I sold electrical. I sold a lot of stuff. And my first job was my first like big boy job was at a company called Kirby Risk, which is in Indiana, which is a big electrical supplier. And my interview was selling a light bulb. So it was me, a 22-year-old moron, and this like 45-year-old pro. And we were up for the same job. And they gave us one of those flat Philips LED bulbs, which is actually, I have it right over here. And they said, sell this to us. And I'm like, what? So I came up with some ridiculous sales pitch, and the other guy forgot his light bulb. And the number one rule in sales is you have to, you know, do the show and tell. So I brought my light bulb, I turned it around, I did my pitch, and I was like, I think I was the youngest Kirby Risk account executive in like the 100-year history. And so that's my professional path. So yeah, industrial sales.
So how'd you get into the podcast industry from being in industrial sales? What was that kind of first step into getting Podchaser off the ground?
Yeah. So, basically I was like driving around all over, Illinois, Chicago area, Indiana, Kentucky, and every day I'd drive 3-4 hours. So that's really great podcast time. So my best friend Cole, he introduced me to podcasting, and he got me into the Tim Ferriss Show specifically. So I was like listening to every episode of the Tim Ferriss Show, and I thought to myself, you know, this is amazing. Like, I am getting access to me 2 or 3 hour long conversations with like billionaires, or artists, or really successful, interesting people. And I felt like a fly on the wall, and I felt like this was a great way for me to gain information for free. So I'm like, this is amazing. So I went to get more into it. I'm a very obsessive person. So I wanted more content. I wanted a discovery tool to find more and more things. So I went to the internet and looked for like an IMDb or Goodreads for podcasting, and I didn't find anything, like nothing at all. So I posted on the podcast subreddit, and I was like, hey, is there an IMDb for podcasts? If not, does anybody want to build it with me? Which is a terrible way to find co-founders, but it worked. And that's how I found our CTO in Melbourne, Australia. His name is Ben. And that's how I got into podcasting, I guess.
So that's probably the best way to describe Podchaser, right? The IMDb for podcasts. So you guys are collecting all that data, and then kind of go into exactly what all Podchaser offers now.
So IMDb is a great analogy. So we do credits collection, meaning who's the guest, the host, the producer, all the people involved in podcasting. We do ratings and reviews. We have the ability to create custom lists with sections and notes. So we're basically this big aggregator of podcast, the available podcast RSS feeds that you can then build upon additional data to help you discover it. So we're big database for nerds, basically.
And when you found your team on Reddit, how did you get to know them, and how did you build that culture over time? You know, nowadays in the day of remote work, you know, that's becoming a norm, but talk about your early days. You know, they're on the other side of the world. You know, you couldn't just, you know, fly across the country and say, hey, let's meet up and meet for a week and kind of get to know each other. Did you do that, or what was that like going, you know, going to those early stages with that?
Yeah. So Podchaser currently, most of our development team is on the other side of the world, whether it's New Zealand, Australia, UK, that region. So yeah, that was hard. Basically, we've never met any of them. We were supposed to meet multiple times at podcast conferences, but the pandemic, or like our Ben has kids and they all had a birthday, like it just never worked. So we've never met. So to answer your question, when I first posted the Reddit post, there were a lot of people who responded to it, and then became a series of like dating kind of, where, you know, we'd all got together in a Google Doc and started kind of putting together the framework for what would become Podchaser. We didn't have a name for it. I think we said podcastdatabase.com or something like that. And it became very clear who knew what they were talking about and who didn't, to me at least. And so it was a series of, you know, I think there's 3 or 4 potential founders that didn't make the cut. So the conversation would be like, hey, like, I don't think this is a good fit, or, you know, I really appreciate you volunteering your time, but it looks like your skill set is not great for what we're doing. And then kind of whittling it down to ultimately Ben and me were from the very beginning, from Skype or Zoom. Zoom wasn't popular at the time, but from the very beginning of these video calls and chatting just online, he and I had very aligned visions for what a Podchaser could be. And so we stuck together, and I think that was the most important part culturally, was just that the founders, there's 4 founders, but the 2 founders at the time had a vision and wanted to accomplish that vision, and the skill set to do so. So that was, once that's aligned, everything works in a perfect world, but it worked for us.
So what did the first version of the product look like? How long, and also how long did it take you guys from when you posted in that Reddit thread until you were had something to show for Podchaser?
I have no idea. I think our first beta version, we were in beta for like a long time. I think it took about 6 months from Reddit post to something on a website. And at that time in Podchaser lore, Ben had recruited his brother-in-law, Ryan, who's now our, he's over all of our design and UX. So he came on board and then obviously helped us design the first iteration. The first iteration was basically a single page that highlighted episodes. And it was like, okay. I mean, it was ratings and reviews only. The credit system was a huge, nasty beast to develop. Still is really difficult. So it was just ratings and reviews, but we were, I believe, the first podcast company ever to have episode level ratings and reviews. So that was what we were trying to surface, was episodic content varies in quality. Like, for example, this interview will probably be the best interview you've ever done.
Sure.
And it's a 5-star compared to your other interviews. I think I saw Keith was on here. So that's like a 1-star review. And it's helpful for future middle tech listeners to filter by the ratings on a catalog of podcast episodes. So that was the first iteration, was basically just a single infinite scrolling page that had episode level ratings and reviews and podcast reviews. And that was about it.
Wow. And talk about the evolution of that, and talk about, you know, what you guys have been launching recently, because you guys have been doing some really exciting stuff. Then I want to dive into that data and where you're getting it.
Yeah. So first of all, one of the smartest things we did, by no, like, I'm not smart, but we accidentally did something smart. We made the first iteration of the website closed, and in order to get access, you had to get an invitation through a code. So we gave podcasters codes, and we generated 3 codes for every person who signed up through. So it was referral, referral, referral. And that got us, I think, like, I don't know, a couple thousand users in the first few weeks. So we're like, oh, this works. So that was important. And the reason I bring that up is because the people coming to us were the people we wanted. So it was podcasters and avid podcast listeners who wanted a more in-depth curation discovery experience in podcasting. And then we immediately put them into a Slack channel, Podchaser community Slack, which I think has like 3,000 or 4,000 people in it now. And it was just like a group of a few dozen fanatics that talked about Podchaser and talked about what it could be, what they wanted out of it as a podcaster or as a professional or as a listener. And that's where we formed a lot of what became our kind of core feature set, was basically direct feedback from our initial core user base.
Love that. And so the data you guys are collecting comes from several sources. You guys are an aggregator, so you're integrating with other sources and aggregating that and providing that as a product to people to search IMDb. Talk about, you know, some of the more specific data that you guys are now starting to surface that you guys are monetizing even further with some of these pro plans and what that looks like and how you plan to monetize into the future.
Yeah. So, ultimately the value in Podchaser is people use it and come to it, find it generally through Google searches. So, if you Google like best episodes of Joe Rogan, we're the first result, sometimes the second, but usually the first. So like that's a way for us to acquire new people, is people are looking to discover shows and our users are the ones creating those lists of best episodes of Joe Rogan, for example. So as far as like our data assets, our curation ability from avid podcast listeners is really strong, and that's a great SEO generator and user acquisition strategy. It's product-led growth, which is what we believed in from the beginning. We don't spend money on user acquisition or growth. It comes to us because of our product. So that curation list ability was a big deal. And then our credit system is another huge piece of our data. And that is, we have over, I think, nearly 8 million credits now throughout podcasting, which is just amazing. Most of which is crowdsourced by our users. So they will come in, like you guys have added credits, I've added credits, everyone adds credits to the machine. And that is a great way to discover people, shows, content, etc. And then since we've been able to integrate and pull in data from hosting platforms and player apps, we have all this diverse data set that represents actual play data from millions of different podcast listeners. And we can take that in aggregate and take stabs at the popularity and reach to a pretty incredible degree of accuracy of all podcasts. So gone are the days of having no idea the reach of a podcast. On Podchaser, the pro plan is basically you can unsurface the popularity, the demographics, the contact information for, you know, over 1 million podcasts. So that was, it took a long time to figure out, obviously, and to get that data coming in. Getting that data in the first place was really hard, but then being able to figure out, how to extrapolate and how to, get accuracy and, get these demographics and get everything together, was just like this juggling, feat. But we finally packaged it all together and that's the pro product. And I think you asked me something else, but I forgot.
Yeah. That's a really big deal, because just from our perspective and just, you know, knowing what we've gone through with growing middle tech and knowing like we're just now starting to get into this world of monetization and wanting to monetize this thing, and we see a path to it. But the barrier to that path has always been the data. It's been so hard for us to understand how to communicate our value. Because we know our value, we're able to talk about it, but like we don't have anything to show, right? And there's two sides to like a pitch. You know, there's the vision, you're able to communicate, you know, what you do and the value you produce, but then you have to like show the results.
Yeah, and one of the things you just kind of showed us on the pro version of the platform that we went over before we hopped on the recording was this median income or mean income of our listeners and like the top jobs that they held. That was something that I think I've viewed on Twitter before, but I've never been able to see it for actual podcast listeners. Mm-hmm. So to be able to look and say, okay, the, you know, average salary of the people who listen to our podcast is this, and this is the top professions of the people that listen to our podcast. I think that's probably one of the most valuable pieces of data that we could have on our podcast, almost right up there with the amount of listens that we're getting on each episode as well. So I'm sure all that data is hugely valuable. And it seems like all of these companies that are raising good amounts of money right now have lots of data. So have you guys raised any money, and talk a little bit about what fundraising with Podchaser has looked like so far?
Yeah. So back to the Canon. So we did the private beta and started getting some traction. And then, I mean, I had at the time no clue what a VC was. I probably didn't know what it stood for. So we started getting inbound requests for funding. And I'm like, okay, this is interesting. People will give me money, and then with the promise of maybe statistically very low probability of me then returning that money to them 10x, 100x, et cetera. That's pretty cool. So we basically decided, like, we kind of validated. I think the first step was validation. And so the way we did that was I needed to find out more about IMDb. I had no understanding of the business model or the size of the company. So I reached out to John Gibbons, who he'll probably listen to this. He's a amazing guy, amazing friend. And he was the seventh employee at IMDb and head of international revenue. So he was there from the very early days and understood, one of the very few people in the world who could explain to me and understand, you know, a product-led growth database of media nerds. So it's a very specific thing. So I reached out to him, and he and I really hit it off, and he explained to me the scale and the power of data, and how IMDb is also, the majority of the data is crowdsourced from users. So it's great. So it's like Craigslist. Like, it's people are doing the data for you, essentially. So once I talked to him, it was clear that we had a lot of potential, that the company could be, like, I mean, IMDb's been around for, what, 30 years. No one's ever going to compete with them because they have this incredible user-generated moat around them. So we kind of realized that, did some research, and then I just started, like, emailing random, like, Chamber of Commerce and, like, KSTC and KEF, and slowly made my way through meetings in Kentucky, 90% of which were like, what's a podcast? And you don't have revenue, so please get out of my office. Eventually, I met Paul Ellinger, who at the time was with the Kentucky Enterprise Fund, and Kelby. And let me mute that noise coming in. Okay, so Paul and Kelby. So I met Paul Ellinger with KEF and Kelby Price, and they managed the Kentucky Enterprise Fund. And I like pitched them, like, hey, this is what could be, and we need money to be able to do this full time and to really see if it's got legs. So they were the first meeting I had where they had a positive response. So at the end of the meeting, I remember I said, so what's wrong with my pitch? Like, what did I do wrong? And they're like, you didn't do anything wrong. What are you talking about? Like, this sounds really cool. I'm like, oh, okay. This is okay, great. So from there, I met Gil Holland, who introduced me to somebody who introduced me to somebody and ended up being like, I think 15 to 20 angels, and Kentucky Enterprise Fund. And we raised our first like pre-seed, whatever you want to call it, through with a safe. which again, raising a safe with a pre-revenue company in Kentucky was wild at the time. I think it's more commonplace now, but at the time, a couple of years ago, it was like, what's a safe? And so that was our first round of funding that gave us like 12 to 18 months to hire some people full time. And then earlier this year, we closed our seed round. So we've raised a total of $2.1 million since we got started.
Yeah. And when you talk to the person that had been the seventh employee at IMDb, your biggest takeaway seemed to be their business model and the way they grew. But you know, looking into your future, they got acquired by Amazon, if I remember that correctly. What do you see your future? And do you envision a similar future where you reach this critical mass of having this moat and you're able to provide substantial value in the form of some kind of data to somebody like maybe a Spotify or an Apple, you know, somebody that's providing and the distribution of these podcasts? Why not mix the data? Where do you see the future of Podchaser going?
Yeah. So yeah. IMDb was purchased by Amazon. It was a very clearly smart acquisition because it at the time was driving DVD sales. So people would come find Tom Cruise was the actor on whatever movie and then be able to find that movie and buy it. So that was an easy value add for Amazon. But from a data perspective, IMDb was able to amass a massive user base and data set that was completely unique. Fairly quickly, relatively quickly, because they were able to empower their user base and crowdsource. So we definitely see similarities there where we believe that long-standing moat is what it's all about. Despite who might have bought IMDb, if IMDb had never been acquired, it still would be IMDb, it'd still be around. And so, yeah, we believe that Podchaser can be that sort of agnostic hub of data for the podcast industry, which obviously, in my mind, is going to continue to grow and surpass radio, for example.
Yeah. Yeah. No, we totally agree as well. And that's kind of where we wanted to transition the meat of this conversation as well, is kind of what's going on in the podcast industry. So let's kind of start by your observations of how you've seen the podcast industry evolve since you first started working on Podchaser.
Yeah, so there's the early podcasters. We're all like tech enthusiast, you know, nerds who tend to be the early adopters of many sorts of technology and believe very much so in the integrity of the RSS feed, of the free and open distribution of podcast through an RSS feed served to a player via MP3 or whatever. So that was the impetus of podcasting, was we want to be able to communicate freely and openly, full stop. That's awesome. I mean, I think that podcasting, especially in our super bizarre media landscape that we live in now, it's probably the last form of media that's truly open and free. Everything else has been corporatized. So like Facebook or Twitter or Spotify or all of these big megacorps, they have some sort of responsibility for the content on their platform. And so there is some sort of required censorship or moderation, whatever you want to call it. So the problem with that is that because of the open and free distribution, there are limitations to the RSS feed. The pro to that is that it's a pretty private, effective, cheap system. It's efficient. The downside to that is the amount of data that you're able to collect on things like demographics or, you know, exact downloads, attribution. It's tough. So herein lies the current problem. What Spotify is doing is not served through an RSS feed. So because of that, there's a higher degree of control and there's an easier path to dynamic ad insertion and scalable revenue. The problem with that is that a lot of people who are drawn to podcasts are allergic to that sort of targeting. So like you guys said, like it's frustrating that a podcast has a certain lack of data, but at the same time, it's kind of liberating that there is a form of media out there that is still free of ridiculously targeted ads. So there's tension there, and that is why the data piece is a bit slow moving. I personally see a world in which it's okay, like the two sides can come together, and if Spotify has their way, which they are certainly investing heavily and wisely in many cases, then the RSS feed, I think, will always be around, but maybe half of the way we deliver podcasts instead of, you know, 95%. So yeah, that's the kind of the issue. And that's the reason data is so behind, is because of fragmentation and this open, cool thing. And so it's, do we mess up the cool thing so that we can monetize it better, or do we keep it the way it is? Or I don't know.
You're leading perfectly into one question that I want to ask is thoughts on the Joe Rogan situation. Cause that is literally the side that you mentioned, you know, the open free speech world, which Joe Rogan is, I think, one of the most important people in media because of that belief of his. And then you've been talking about how Spotify is doing this on the commercial side. Talk about how you view that and where you see that going and what that means for the future of podcasting. Cause now they've got, you know, Michelle Obama and Kim Kardashian, some of these other amazing people out there getting these exclusive licenses and rights to. Where do you see this heading? Like, what does that mean for the podcast space?
The Joe Rogan acquisition was the savviest possible way for Spotify to increase their MAUs to drive ad dollars. No doubt about it. The attractiveness to podcasting to Spotify, of course, is that there's no licensing fees, but there in a sense is with $100 million to Joe Rogan. So, I think that was a shock to the podcasting world, specifically because I think Joe Rogan has always been so pro podcast, and I mean, the open, free, cool part about podcasting propelled him to, you know, what I think he's up to like 300 million downloads a month. It's just
wild.
So he from what we see, he is number one by like a factor of two.
Oh my gosh.
It's pretty amazing. So yeah, I think that was a pretty big shock to the podcast industry, because it was in a sense like one of us. It came from nothing. Joe Rogan had like Fear Factor celebrity, but he wasn't Michelle Obama.
Well, he was grinding on his podcast for years and years.
11 yeah. years. Yeah. 11
exactly.
years.
Exactly. And so making. I think everybody expected the converting celebrity to podcast listens, and it's an effective solution plan, like with Michelle Obama, Conan O'Brien. I think everybody expected that, but to do it with Joe Rogan was forced the industry to look inwards to say like, well, now what? So, and then he will be behind that walled garden. I mean, you won't be able to listen to Joe Rogan unless you have Spotify. Very effective user acquisition strategy.
Very.
But very, very much the antithesis to the essence of podcasting. So how that plays out, I expect Joe Rogan's listenership will obviously go down. If he's not on YouTube, which is a huge platform, and if he's not on Apple Podcasts and Google Podcasts and all the other podcatchers, then his listenership will likely go down and suffer somewhat of a hit, but who cares? He made $100 million. So like, I think Michelle Obama also went from exclusive to non-exclusive, probably to capture some more listenership before going fully exclusive. So, for Spotify, it's great. I mean, I think it was really smart and probably worth the money. I don't know if you saw their stock price right after they did the acquisition, yeah, but it was
about 100%.
Went up like $1 billion in market cap or something crazy. So yeah, I think it was really smart from a business strategy or perspective. But from podcasting as a whole, it definitely was a blow to this idea of this open, free ecosystem that we've all come to kind of love. And honestly, personally, when I saw the news, I was kind of sad, because, and I'm not saying I have no comment on Joe Rogan's political or the guests he has on, but standing back from that, Joe Rogan was free and open, and could have the liberty to interview who he wanted. And now that's going to change, for sure. It's going to change.
Yeah,
that's not saying it's good or bad, but that's going to change. And that is, for podcasting as a whole, it brings up a lot of problems for sure.
Yeah. That was my biggest worry.
If it does actually change, and I want to remain optimistic that he wouldn't sell out. I kind of was reaffirmed on that a little bit when he brought on Alex Jones again. Not that I'm a big Alex Jones fan, but I was like, okay, that seems like kind of a almost middle finger to everyone who was saying he was getting censored by Spotify, because I think it's really important that podcasting maintains this sort of free and open sort of thing, because I feel like that's why the space has grown so much recently, is because it's kind of like that last line of defense. Exactly like you said, it's the last place where people can go and share thoughts openly and freely.
It's a stream of consciousness.
And I think that Joe Rogan was the perfect person to kind of be that partnership with Spotify, because he's been so vocal about being that. So okay, I really hope that it doesn't turn into censoring who he can have on and fundamentally change his podcast, because that'll be a really sad day for everything once it finally does go that way.
He became bigger than podcasts, you know? Yeah. He's like the free speech. Like when you think of free speech, like first one that comes to my mind is Joe Rogan, because one, he doesn't really show bias towards different political views. Like he definitely shares his political views, but he makes sure to have both sides on his podcast and share their thoughts. And you know, like Bradley said, I hope that doesn't change, and it's showing signs that it might be changing. You know, Spotify's employees and things that have happened, you know, certain episodes have been dropped and like had technical issues. You know, it's kind of scary what's happened so far, but I really hope it doesn't. I wanted to ask, do you see a path as far as monetization goes and how Spotify is, you know, they're investing heavily in this. They've obviously got some kind of vision on really monetizing podcasts to a drastic extent beyond just getting the rights, you know, to exclusivity. Do you ever view a time in history where it'll be programmatic ad buying like it is with TV, where like, so with Anchor, and I always kind of like pictured and had a belief that this could be possible, but you know, they acquired Anchor. And in Anchor, you could leave certain parts of your podcast open, and then you could insert ads. Do you ever see a world where they create this marketplace where podcast creators upload their podcasts with certain clips removed for ad space, and then they upload that to a marketplace and businesses, you know, put that ad snippet in there? Do you view that being possible in the near future, this programmatic ad buying that we're used to in so many other mediums, or are we a ways off from that?
I mean, we're there now. That's why Spotify acquired Anchor. So that Spotify is essentially doing that. Most of the major publishers are doing dynamic ad insertion. Sometimes you don't even know it because it's native dynamic ad insertion. So it's host read, which is pretty cool, because the host read ads are much more effective. And so if you can programmatically insert ads that don't seem inserted, that's kind of the holy grail. So that's certainly where we are. I think in many ways Spotify is kind of YouTubeizing the entire stack from upload to monetization. So just like YouTube, you can upload a video, monetize it, get a check. Spotify is doing the same thing. I think that, in my view, I don't think that's necessarily a bad thing. I think that there will likely still be kind of the independent podcasters out there who monetize through other means, especially with podcasts within specific niches. You can probably get a little bit more money out of your content. It's the same thing with YouTube. You still have direct brand sponsorships that are not programmatic. So I think in a way it's a good thing for the industry that there's a proven model that can increase revenue for podcasting. So if that means the whole industry grows, that's a good thing. But listeners in general are not huge fans of dynamic ad insertion, they love when the host talks about their Casper mattress natively. So it'll keep getting smarter and better, and it's not going anywhere anytime soon. I think dynamic ad insertion will certainly be a big piece of the puzzle for monetization.
Where do you see the competitive landscape shifting? So Spotify is investing heavily. Apple really hasn't shown the same willingness to invest heavily, unless I missed some of that. YouTube really isn't playing and doesn't seem to be playing in the podcast space, except for they're hosting a lot of the videos. Over time, as the monetization improves and the space continues to grow, what is the space going to look like?
Spotify certainly gaining grounds pretty rapidly. Spotify is transparently interested in increasing the amount of people who use Spotify on a monthly basis, so that they can serve more ads and increase their ad business. That's their model. Daniel Ek has said that from the get-go. He wants more content, so podcasts that don't have a heavy licensing fee to music studios, and wants to increase the amount of ads he can serve to those users. So that's their strategy. And again, it's working. Apple is generally not a very ad-heavy company at all. So they're much more interested in services. So I would imagine that there will be a battle. And again, it doesn't mean one's going to win from the other necessarily. It probably will be coexisting, to where you'll probably always have the podcast with the ad in some way, shape, or form. Then you'll also have the ability to subscribe to that podcast or that network to remove that ad. You can do this today with many networks have their own plus product or pro product, so that you can remove ads or get bonus content, but it's not very easily done natively inside any of these apps. So there will likely be a really annoying walled garden subscription package that Apple will provide. There'll probably be one that Spotify will provide. There may be eventually one where Google provides one, and then each network's going to have one. It's going to turn into cable television. I mean, cable TV, if you remember TV 10 years ago, there's an ad every 5 seconds. And now there's so many ads in TV. Consumers got really fed up with it. Then they started, then subscription packages started coming along. Netflix came along. Hulu came along. And so I think podcasting, the ads are going to start driving everybody crazy, and they're going to start subscribing directly to the publishers via the major platforms.
Makes a ton of sense. I think you laid that out perfectly. I can see that path for sure. All right. So let's give some advice for anybody listening, including ourselves. You have this vast experience with podcasts that we want to learn from. What are some tips that you want to give to new podcast founders or those that are wanting to get into the space?
I don't have a podcast, so I can only share what I've seen from the podcasters.
But you have one of the biggest databases on podcasts in the entire world.
True. So from what we've seen, I think that, first of all, and this is such cliche advice, but buy a microphone. You don't have to buy a $500 thing. You just start with the $20 USB microphone. So make sure, I think the quality standard has gone drastically up, because there's nearly 100,000 new podcasts every month that are published, which is just
that's crazy. Insane.
So to be able to fight through that noise, if you think that you can just upload a podcast episode and it doesn't even sound good, and you think you're just going to get listeners, that's not going to happen. So definitely encourage people to build a community first, build an email list, offer some sort of value, whether it's content or physical values of some sort, before launching your podcast. Because kind of like with Podchaser, you want to validate the need for what you're putting out there before you just put it out there. I guarantee you, if you want to get with your two buddies and talk about Marvel and DC comics in your basement, no one's going to listen to it. there's 500,000 of them, like no one's going to listen to it. So certainly differentiate your content. And it's all about, like, life's all about finding your niche. And like, you guys are like Kentucky based startups. Like that's a niche. Good. So that's what you need. And then once you, like for you guys, it's like Kentucky. And then obviously once you get your Kentucky crowd, you can expand to the Midwest and then ultimately to like this side of the country. Like you can then expand that audience once you've nailed down your what gets your fans excited and gets them coming back. So yeah, I mean, that's really generic advice, but nobody follows it. So if they were to follow it, it would probably be effective.
I think the part where you speak about building a community, that really resonates with me, because I think that's when we really started growing an audience, is when we made a really concerted effort to put out good content on social media. Then we started getting into video as well, and just had all of these different mediums that are all centered around that audio that we record here. Like we find, you know, 10 different ways to distribute what we're actually recording into these microphones. And I think that's what builds that audience that, you know, ultimately drives the podcast itself forward. I think that's one of the most important parts of doing what we're doing here. But to kind of wrap things up here, we always like ending on a forward-looking statement. So where do you see Podchaser and the podcast industry going into the future in the next 3 to 5 years?
Podchaser is not going anywhere. I think we will continue to grow. We are thinking very carefully about exactly what we just talked about. So where does your podcast community live? Right now, they live on many different platforms. So we're thinking about going into 2021. We have a big initiative around community building within podcasting on Podchaser through chat, discussions, forums, that sort of structure. To draw a comparison, IMDb discussion boards were legendary, and they got rid of them because at the time, the spam technology was not quite as good as it is today. The flaming, anti-flaming sort of technology was not as good as it is today. So anyway, for Podchaser, we want to be the hub of the whole thing. We want people to come to us directly to discover, but also to be utilizing our data, not even knowing it, because we're serving data to other platforms. So super cool, super exciting, Podchaser for president. And then for the industry as a whole, it's going to continue to double every year and get bigger and bigger. I think we'll continue to see this awesome, frothy M&A activity increase. You're going to be seeing more crazy numbers of giant corporations buying startups, and content's going to get better, and it's going to get harder to get an audience from a podcaster perspective. But the whole pie, I think, will continue to grow for sure. I've always said that fiction is probably the most exciting space from a content perspective. When I say fiction, people are probably thinking like, what's that? Exactly. Like that's the problem. Like fiction dominates, every other media, books, TV, movies, and then podcasts. There's a big base of fiction fans, audio drama, radio drama, depending on what you call it. So that is just going to get bigger, and I don't see why it won't be the biggest thing eventually. But right now, I think the limitation is that to do scripted, fictionalized content, you have to have a very high production quality. And that's a little bit antithetical to podcasting, because like you can just buy a couple microphones and go. So like sound design and production, I think that's going to just continue to get better. And then fiction will have a heyday in the next like 3 to 5 years. So
I could definitely see that. I could definitely see fiction. When I went on a road trip one time and we listened to a fiction podcast, it was called like Limetown or something.
Yep.
And it was a big one. It was awesome. It was so cool. It was like they told a story and the sounds, the way they did it and everything. I think that's a great prediction. I think that's something that people
should start. Yep, high production, fictionalized content. Marvel's doing it. Spotify's getting into it. It's going to be really big, but it'll take a while for adoption to happen.
Yeah, I love it. I think that's very true. Well, Bradley, thank you so much for coming on and sharing your insights and your wisdom and telling us a little bit about Podchaser. We're definitely excited to get this one out and hopefully spread the word about what you guys are doing a little bit more.
Awesome. Thanks, guys. It was fun.